Hello. So this is definitely not the second time of trying with Sir Lord Captain, my captain, Dan Bennett. For those of you who don't know Dan, if you've ever heard of Ogilvy or if you've ever heard of Rory Sutherland, Dan is the guy who looks after the Behavioural Science unit at or division at Ogilvy, and is a great friend, a legend, a gentleman, and just knows everything about behavioural science. One of the questions I always get asked, relatively often actually, is how on earth do you get into behavioural science? And I guess that's possibly a good way to start out. How on earth did you get into this this world?
Into this mad world.
I think I remember you telling me there was a funny story.
Yeah, I'm going to be so much better the second time round. Much more articulate. None of the ums and ahs. What was the one way of finding if that's true? So originally, the funny story is that I originally was really interested in philosophy, was a bit dyslexic, and genuinely selected psychology by accident at A level, and then eventually carried on doing that. I got 6 weeks into my philosophy classes, thought they were awesome, but was really confused as to why my friends who had also taken philosophy weren't in there. So it turns out I absolutely loved understanding psychology, why we do what we do, and really took that through to university. And then after that, was in that similar space that everybody was in, of kind of watching loads of TED Talks at the time and kind of just understanding lots about the discipline. And came across Rory Sutherland's and Dan Ariely's TED Talks. They were entertaining. They were useful. They were there was something in them. I don't like to pretend at the age of 21 that I was understanding all of this. I think that's the stuff that you understand in retrospect. But it felt like there was some massive value in bringing behavioural science to the private sector in a way that you would have, as an outsider, would have just presumed that it was all totally used already. Do you know what I mean? Because you hear those great stories that kind of supermarkets spot the smell of bread into the aisle and put the eggs at the back. You just assume that everybody was totally on top of behavioural science. But it turns out a lot of it was happy accidents or kind of individual consultants kind of driving that. And actually there's a real space for kind of doing it more formulaically. So so a bit of an accident at the beginning, a happy accident, and thrilled that behavioural science is still a growing space 10 years on.
Yeah, and it's I always think I feel very, very flattered and honoured to know you. And the reason why is I think, one of the reasons, lots of people know about Rory Sutherland, obviously, but what you don't know is these great people, part of the reason why they are so great is because they surround themselves with amazing people. I think that's true of all of us in life, right? We're all in up to a point standing on the shoulders of giants. And I think one of the reasons why Rory is so great is because he knows you. you're always you're reading a lot of stuff that maybe he isn't. And then there's that sort of, Rory loves chatting, doesn't he? And it's these, I see him when he's with you and with your team. You can see it's like his eyes are just bright. Like you can see him just feeding in all this information. It must be amazing to do, because you're working at Ogilvy, so you get this sort of, you've got a whole wacky creative team as well, which must really help for a behavioural science division.
It is, and I think Rory is one of the most open-minded, inclusive people that I know. Do you know what I mean? He is just so open to all ideas, and which has been such a part of the DNA of the business. And we all know, don't we, kind of in creative environments, there are people that can really thrive in them, and then people whose kind of personality just doesn't suit a creative environment. Kind of, we do a suite of kind of psychological measurement tools, and one of those measurements is, I think it's need for closure or need to kind of get to an answer. And creative people have this special ability, as you know, to not need to know the answer straight away, and can kind of ponder on it and sit on it for kind of weeks, months, years.
Or ever.
Yes. Yeah. And so, but there are some people who, when given a complex question, there's something in their tummy that really doesn't sit well, and they just have to get to an answer quickly. And that doesn't allow for the kind of the exploration time often in order to kind of solve some of these bigger, stickier challenges. So a lot of the DNA of kind of, I think, of Rory and the team is finding people with a low need for closure, are people that can kind of sit on problems for a while, you know, keep to deadlines, but sit on problems within a while and be comfortable with that, because often the stickier challenges don't reveal themselves straight away and do take multiple inputs. It's very often that we would solve a challenge in Ogilvy Consulting in the behavioral science practice without having many different inputs and collating kind of many different unknown data sources often in order to get there. So you kind of got to be comfortable with not knowing the answer for quite a while usually.
Yeah, it kind of reminds me of Hitchhiker's Guide to the Galaxy stuff. It's, you know, the question is more important than the answer. I think that's probably an interesting insight for advertising. It's more about the questions often than getting exactly the right answer. For those of you who don't know, Dan actually helped write the first ever behavioral science course that we made, which was incredibly fun. But I don't know whether it's worth going back to the beginning, sort of before the behavioral science team was, you know, the big sort of multinational global team it is now, because you're now everywhere, right?
Everywhere. And we've worked, I mean, in kind of 20, 30 different countries around the world, many cultures, many contacts. And that has been an amazing thing. I mean, kind of the first 2 or 3 years of the business was really about kind of doing lots of the work that that kind of needed to be done in terms of kind of just matching principles to context and just kind of go, okay, we've got this letter, we've got this call center, we've got this this website, and therefore, okay, we know that these principles of behavioral science exist, we know that if we utilize them we'd be more likely to get to be effective, so let's just start to match those principles to the context. And we'd probably call that kind of behavioral tidying up. You know, there's an element of kind of just trying different things with an experimental mindset and getting some amazing wins. We had with an airline, we used the endowment effect. And, you know, the endowment effect is that idea that you frame something as being positioned and kind of owned by someone to kind of increase their ownership, so they're more likely to act on it. So we changed, you know, when you go on an airline's booking website, you type in your details, you select where you want to go, what class of travel, all that type of thing. And then you click the button, find flights. So we endowment affected that button and added the word my in the middle. So find my flights. And it had a significant increase in the conversion of that button and all the way to purchase. And in the rate of kind of millions of pounds. So especially the first couple of years of the business, there was lots of those kind of butterfly effects to be found of having an experimental mindset, testing quite a few principles and seeing what worked, kind of quite alchemic in that sense of just kind of dropping them in and poof, seeing what happened. And, you know, lots of not, you know, non-events as well. And then after that, I think behavioral science started to get a little bit more productized as the questions that came into the practice were less kind of from kind of curious clients wanting to try something new and kind of like an innovation type way, and more about kind of really wanting to supercharge their existing efforts. So if it was about kind of changing culture or employee well-being or all of these nebulous things that when you think about it, if we boil them down to their kind of behaviors, we can actually tackle them far more powerfully. So, you know, if you think about an organization's culture, it really boils down to nothing more than a series of behaviors that people do. So if we understand that, then we can build kind of behavior change projects around some specific behaviors that if people did them would be driving the culture. So there was lots more of those projects that came about, which was really kind of using behavioral science to kind of as a horizontal discipline to supercharge lots of different efforts, whether it was culture or experience optimization or language development or behavioral campaigns or whatever it was. And then very recently, I think the future of behavioral science is getting much more towards bringing in data science. There really isn't or shouldn't be much difference between data science and behavioral science. So whether in the past it, and it still can be very useful to do this, to kind of mix principles with context. The tricky thing about behavioral science is we don't know which principle works with which person for which behavior in which context. And so if we can map those together, we'll be in a much stronger place. So that's what a lot of our work in more recent years has been about, kind of combining that data science kind of pro audience profiling piece to understand people much better beyond just their demographics, etc. And to be able to kind of have much more precise recommendations of, okay, we've got this person with this personality, or kind of on average, most likely in a second to have this personality. Therefore, this is the persuasion strategy that we can build on. Now let's make something amazing and creative that people love and want to do, but that is rooted in all of those insights. We're in a different place now than we were 10 years ago, put it that way.
Yeah, it sounds like you've got a better telescope on your gun or something, if that's sort of another analogy. Nice. Did you say that you were using, is it the ocean framework, I think, that you talk about a little bit? And I'm saying this in no way to preempt that we've got a new course coming out with you that may or may not touch on some of these things that you're talking about. But I don't know if it's possible to explain a little bit more about that, because I know you were saying you used that a bit more.
Yeah, I mean, absolutely a product placement at the top of the screen right now. It's a great example that I really love, and people may have seen this online, but it's absolutely fantastic, which is we all can picture Prince Charles and the Prince of Darkness, Ozzy Osbourne. They were two very different people. You would never mistake Prince Charles or Ozzy Osbourne in the street. But if we looked at their demographics and their behavioral data, as we often do in marketing, we would see that they are both male. They are both born in 1948. They're both raised in the UK. Both married twice, both lived in a castle, and both wealthy and famous. If we look at their demographic and behavioral data, we would absolutely think they're identical. However, if we look at their personality profiles, if we look at their social and moral worldviews, if we look at their cognitive thinking styles and the way that they think and naturally think, then we would see them as totally different people. So it strikes me that it's much more useful not just to rely on whether they're a millennial woman or, you know, a Gen Z male. It strikes me as that those things are always going to be helpful for targeting, but not always going to be the things that lead us to the insight to know how to persuade someone. And so a lot of the work recently has been around really, really trying to profile audiences based on those metrics so we can then create kind of product and services that really suit who they are and how they think. So it's amazing. So if you're not familiar with ocean or the big five personality traits, it really boils down to five. So one of them is openness. So are you open to new experiences or not? And we all vary on that. And as I go through these, you'll be able to think of friends and family that are extremes on either end. Openness tends to decline with age as well. After the age of 60, usually it goes down quite fast. Conscientiousness, are you kind of a Hermione Granger or not? Do you hand your homework in or not? Creative people tend to be less conscientious and very high on openness. So that can be interesting for an organizational culture, for timesheets, etc. Then we've got extroversion and introversion. And we all, and sometimes you can be a bit in the middle, a bit of both, but people tend to kind of index either extrovert or introverted. Agreeableness. So agreeable people are terrible at negotiations, I think. And you can kind of, a lot of that is down to kind of like past experiences and the like. And then there's kind of emotionally stable or neurotic. Do you kind of fly off the handle quite easily or not? And that's a very unfair characteristic of the element there. But essentially, once you know kind of more about someone's profile, you can then know how to persuade them a bit better. So we have some research to suggest that if you're extroverted, which I think you are, Chris, then you're much more likely to be persuaded by social proof, knowing what everybody else is doing. Whether if you're introverted, some situations, you're much more likely to be persuaded by loss aversion and people pointing out what you stand to lose rather than what you stand to gain. If you're neurotic, then kind of warning people about kind of the downsides of an action is helpful, but not to go too far along the journey with that, because it will kind of just bring the shutters down. It's helpful to use an authority figure with people on the neurotic end of the spectrum, because that again helps with that kind of compliance thing. So if we know more about who someone is, we can know which principles to use. If we know which principles to use, we can create those better product and experiences and services that that are gonna, you know, engage people.
Did you find something interesting about yourself when you learned about this?
Oh, that's a great question. I've always known I'm very agreeable, but I think there's some magic.
I think I'm the same.
Yes, I agree. We both agree. This is why we should never be allowed to have a negotiation together. But I think there's something about having things a little bit quantified about yourself, which is very confirmatory. And so I do think, yeah, there's elements I was kind of aware of. And also it's one of those things where people are desperate to have like the right one. So, you know, people think, oh, being open is the right one, being conscientious is the right one, extrovert is the right one. But it turns out it depends on which end of the spectrum you are, just depends what kind of job you're good at. Rory's amazing example, which cracks me every time, is that in terms of kind of having people that are open-minded and try new things and creative versus people that are closed-minded and follow a rigid process all the time, you don't want, when you're sat on the tarmac, someone who's fixing the aeroplane to go, oh, let's try anti-clockwise this time against their training. You know, you want them to follow rules and processes. So, you know, there are times when you need a different profile. And there's a lot of research to say that the happiest you are is if you've found a job that matches your psychological profile, because you kind of can't fake it and it doesn't really change that much.
It'd be great if there was a tool that existed that had that. Maybe there is. If there is, please let me know. If anyone's listening and they know, please let us know. I know you work with an incredible array of clients. Are there any sort of interesting ones, past or present, where, you know, maybe some of these kind of insights have helped lead you to an elegant behavioral solution?
Well, there was one that really won. We've had, you know, there's more than one, but there was one that I really find interesting to talk about because it was a really lateral solution to an age-old problem. And it was all to do with hand washing. And we've all had a crash course in hand washing over the past couple of years. I mean, I know I'm pretty good at it, and most of the time the habit's sticking now, which is pretty good. However, the trick to that was buying expensive soap. As soon as I bought expensive soap, I washed my hands every single time because I was just loving the smell. But there's a really great solution, which is not really a kind of an advertising solution that you might expect coming out of a big creative network, but it was quite a small solution. And so essentially it was getting people to wash their hands when they go into a food processing factory and when they leave a food processing factory. Now, this was an abattoir, so you would expect that hand washing behavior would naturally happen because you wouldn't want to bring any nasties into the factory and you wouldn't want to take any nasties home with you to your family. However, dynamics are how they are, and hand washing wasn't happening to kind of the compliant rates that they needed to be. And that creates really big challenges, because if you don't have the right level of hand washing compliance in the factory, it becomes almost a $1 billion problem, because you have, collectively. So you have to pay a fine to the brands that you're doing product recall on. You have to do a product recall. You have to close the factory, cease kind of production, and kind of deep clean the entire place, and then obviously lose a bit of kind of reputational gain, then you start to lose contracts ongoing. So just because we can't get the right level of hand washing in the factory has, you know, ongoing knock-on challenges. So, for decades, they tried every trick in the book. So they tried paying people more to wash their hands. They tried paying people less if they didn't wash their hands. They tried group incentives. They tried group disincentives. They tried the blue lights. They tried the education. Everything you can imagine just doesn't always get to the right level of kind of habitual hand washing that one would like. So what we were able to do is kind of travel over there. This was in Chile, I think, and audit the environment for those really small elements in the environment that might be kind of nudging the behavior either way. And from there, we were able to kind of really identify the kind of the missing prompts and the kind of the interventions that weren't really working. what we managed to develop was quite a lateral solution. So it was essentially, we developed a hand stamp. It was a hand stamp with a sticky ink on the inside that we developed. And the sticky ink took the same amount of time to wash off your hands as was the amount of time that you have to wash your hands for. So you'd have your hand stamped before you go into the hand washing bay. You would then have to wash off that sticky ink, which would mean that you're washing your hands for much longer and much more compliantly. And then you would leave the hand washing bay either with a stamp saying you basically haven't washed your hands, quite a social signal, or a clean hand and you could carry on. And we were doing quite stringent measurements, and overnight we saw a 63% reduction in dirty hands by the presence of the stamp.
Wow.
And no one at the beginning of the process, it's what I find really interesting, no one at the beginning of the process would have said to solve this kind of category $1 billion problem, it would be through the power of a stamp. You'd think there'd need to be some kind of regulation or scientific intervention or structural intervention. But in fact, the power of a little sticky stamp was the thing that made the difference, and it even made the difference across all shifts. So the night shift is the one where you get some quite dip in some of the hand washing compliance rates because the management aren't around, it's the cloak of darkness, all those types of things. But it worked across all shifts, and it kind of works in perpetuity too. So it's one of those kind of unexpected solutions that really special about behavioral science is that it's the missing seat at the table. I don't think it should be the only seat at the table. I think it's quite arrogant to think that behavioral scientists and no one else, thanks, can solve this one. And I think in the early days of behavioral science, there probably was a little bit of need to prove the discipline. And so I think kind of by inviting behavioral scientists, designers, researchers, all together, in people with an innovation mindset to solve some of these problems, and creative people as well, like behavioral science and creativity is a great combination for solving some of these stickier challenges, then we're starting to solve problems that other disciplines by themselves can't. And so kind of working at the intersection of those things is actually getting us to solve challenges that haven't been solved before. And I think that's the value add to behavioral science. I think that's the, if someone said, what's the purpose of it? You know, I think it's to unite interesting disciplines to solve problems that can't be solved by kind of a mono solution. So I think that's what's really exciting. That's why, even though it's a story about a sticky stamp, it's actually a story about so much more, really.
So much to unpack on what you've just said.
I've had a lot of coffee.
An incredible story. So congrats. But I mean, a couple of things came to mind. One was just as you were closing up there, I was thinking, actually, you know, I think over the years, you know, sadly, the importance of advertising and their place in companies has sort of laddered down somewhat. It's I think where advertising used to have a seat at the table when business decisions were being made back in the day, I think that's very rare now. And it's interesting that sort of sounds like behavioral science is one of those ways to help get that seat back. Yeah, it reminded me of that thing that Rory often says, which is advertising. In advertising, our job is often to make the new familiar and the familiar new. And it's, I think it is that perfect bridge between maybe the business side of things and the creative side of things, where you can maybe explain why the creative works a bit more. Because often I think the reason why advertising is put aside is because you can't really explain your working or your thinking. Sort of, it's not like you're when you're in accounting where it's like, I did this and so this happened. I think adding the behavioral science bit maybe helps with that maths bit. It's the, you know, we did this and so this happened because of X, Y, and Z. I think that's fascinating point. So firstly, bravo. And secondly, just going back a little bit more into what you were saying, is how on earth did you get to the solution of a hand stamp, apart from you know, were you doing a lot of clubbing when you were out in wherever you were in South America?
And we got the hand stamp, the inspiration from waking up with a hand stamp on our head. Yeah, sadly not. That wasn't the case. But a lot of the way that we get to the solutions is through lateral thinking techniques and lateral stimulation. So what do we mean by that? So there's an element of what we believe is that every problem has been solved. It just hasn't been solved in your category yet. So what's really helpful, what you were saying about behavioral science being this kind of codification of persuasion, kind of this idea that it's a codex for how to change people's behavior. By boiling down challenges to their kind of psychological components and kind of the psychological barriers, it allows us to then hunt outside of the category in a much more kind of sophisticated way to find how other people have overcome challenges of non-salience, for example, with the hand stamp, or a lack of kind of social feedback. That's what all the things the hand stamp was doing, was giving you the idea that if I don't wash this off, I'm going to have a little bit of kind of awkwardness when I leave here because I got my dirty stamp on my hand. And we get a lot of that by going, okay, let's hunt for lack of social feedback or lack of kind of social compliance. Let's hunt for that in a range of different categories, you know, from the military to how airlines work to how, you know, far and beyond, to get the inspiration of the kind of the mechanics that they use to overcome those psychological challenges. And then we'll make it our own. We'll do it in our way, in our category. But we'll get that inspiration. I think one of the best things that behavioral science can do is open up the solution space, if that makes sense, to kind of like get us to, rather than just having a good think about how we shift someone's behavior, let's have a more systematic kind of forensic exploration into how all the mechanics work. And then let's use that as creative stimulus to come up with our own way, if that makes sense.
Yeah, it makes a lot of sense, and you're very good at it. So congratulations.
Stop it.
the other thing that I would be remiss not to talk about is nudge stock. I wondered. I mean, it's nudge stock when we're recording this at the end of May, so we're not too far away from the 10th anniversary of nudge stock. And I think you've been around since the start, I think, if I remember rightly. And I mean, because it started off as a sort of a bolt on to another festival, I think, if I remember rightly. I mean, I'm saying all this as we, again, this is we're about to launch a totally free course celebrating Nudge Stock. We've picked the best talks from each of the last 10 years and made it into a little course for everyone. But yeah, Dan, I thought it'd be amazing if you could just share a little bit about how it started and where it's gone to, how it's evolved, and then maybe where it might be heading. Lot to unpack there for you.
Absolutely. No, and we're so excited about Nudge Stock. It's on the 10th of June. It's going to be 10 hours long. So it's going to be pretty easy to remember in that sense. And it's the 10th year as well. So 10, 10, 10. That was actually quite a fluke. It wasn't actually much of a design, but we're very lucky on that. So it began as, I mean, so our co-founders of the business, Jez Groom and Rory Sutherland, had the idea for the event and to really kind of galvanize a community around this kind of different way to solve challenges. And I think they had a belief in the early days to that behavioral science applied in a creative way would solve challenges that other disciplines can't, and so working that intersection could solve challenges other disciplines can't. And so the festival began as you said, we were into prototyping. So it started as kind of an addition to Digital Shoreditch, which was a great place for us to start. And we galvanized kind of hundreds of people around this at the intersection of behavioral science and creativity. And we had some amazing speakers. Even in the first year, we had Laurie Santos, who's a great expert in monkeynomics. She now works a lot more in happiness. We had Nassim Taleb, and the list goes on and on. And for many years, we did it kind of different seaside locations. So we did it in Deal, we've done it in Folkestone, and we took hundreds of people to Folkestone and to Deal to kind of experience the best of behavioral science creativity.
What's the seaside fascination, apart from this, you know, good to get some sea air?
So the first one was that Deal had Rory's summer house nearby. So I think that was convenient for him. But the real reason for going by the seaside was that it's taking people to a context where they would think differently. So we didn't want to create yet another, we didn't want to chuck yet more money and yet more stuff into London where people would kind of nip across for a couple of hours and then nip away. We wanted to make sure it was a festival that people were kind of bought into. And so we picked it by the seaside, put it in a context where you would naturally think differently and naturally kind of like step out for the full day. And we also made it a great experience. Used to get a little gin and tonic for the train ride home and all that kind of thing. But the idea is that you really want to make sure that the 500 people that came were complete kind of believers and really up for it. So we had a great, great community feel. And then the pandemic struck and we went online. And I think in the first year we had over 120,000 views of the content. So it went very quickly from kind of 500 to 120,000. And although we all miss our trips to the seaside, it's amazing to be able to engage, especially as our team has become much more global, to engage a global audience. And kind of the speakers that we're able to get. Last year we had John Cleese. It would have been harder to get John Cleese to Folkestone, I imagine. But it was really, I would happy take the whole conference where John Cleese is, to be honest. But the kind of the quality of the speakers are amazing. And this year, it's our 10th anniversary. And so we've got a great suite of speakers. We've got Maya Shankar, who's the behavioural science leader at Google and used to be behavioural science leader at the White House. We've got Milena Vinsky, who's a head of behavioural science at IBM and does a bit of their AI work as well. We've got a super secret keynote speaker that I'm not allowed to talk about yet, but keep an eye out for that, and it's going to be, everyone's going to love it. It's going to be amazing. And we've also got Dan Pink talking about his latest book as well. So it's going to be an amazing, amazing day. We're also this year, because the downside of a physical conference is that you don't get to meet like-minded others. You're kind of just sat there watching the TV show broadcast at home. So this year we have built a custom built metaverse that we're calling the Nudgeverse. So basically a massive virtual art gallery that people can walk around, they can learn more about behavioral science, they can watch old Nudge Doc talks, they can learn a bit more about the metaverse as well and speak to our partners, but they can also speak to each other and network and meet each other. You don't need the headset for that. It's even better with the headset, but you can do it through your browser as well. So hopefully people are gonna really enjoy going into the Nudgeverse this year as a new addition to the Nudge Doc family.
Wow, that sounds amazing. Who have you built that with out of interest?
A company called Acast, or a part of Ogilvy.
Okay, awesome. Looking forward to that. And what were some of your highlights from some of your favourite talks in the past years, apart from the ones that you've done yourself, of course?
Favourite talks. I thought it was such a special moment when we had John Cleese at Nudge Doc. Because it was one of those people where we always pride ourselves at Nudge Doc of trying to get people who either don't do the kind of the normal speaker circuit, or if they do, they do something that's quite bespoke to us. And we'd found out that John Cleese was kind of secretly kind of best friends with some kind of top psychologist and was really interested into the psychology of creativity. But he hadn't really spoken that publicly about it for kind of many years. And so when we approached him and we talked about it, I think he enjoyed it, speaking to his tribe as much as we enjoyed having him there. And so it was a real kind of, I think we feel like we discovered talent. We're not saying we discovered John Cleese, but we certainly managed to kind of find that, that I can't lay claim to that, but we certainly managed to find
another side of topic. Him, perhaps.
Exactly. And I think Rory and John have been kind of best friends ever since. So that's what we're going for this year. And I think you're going to see a lot. I don't want to spoil the fun for everyone, but on the Friday, the 10th of June, there's 10-hour content that it's going to be pretty special.
That's amazing. And to find that, you just need to go to, I think you've got your own website as well, isn't it? So is it just nudgestock.com or is it .co.uk?
Nudgestock.com. And the tickets are free. You can sign up now. And it takes just a couple of minutes and it's super easy. You'll get the emails and then you'll get your invitation to the Nudgeverse as well. So definitely nudgestock.com as soon as you can.
It's definitely the best thing you'll do all year as far as events go. It's incredible. And next year, are you looking at perhaps possibly doing some sort of a hybrid thing? Or obviously the digital side of it is so huge now, it'd be crazy to stop that. But do you think you'll get back to to a hybrid something in the next year or two?
It is something that we're exploring. It's kind of tough because you have to make a choice about where you put the attention for the audience and the presenters. Like, do you go for the, if we do hybrid,
Right.
is the focus the tens of thousands of people at home, or is it the 500 people in the room? Like, do the tens of thousands of people at home overlook the event of the in-person event, or do the people at the event overlook the TV broadcast? So there's all those kind of questions. We've had some mad ideas in the past. We did have an idea, and we were very serious about it, and it very nearly happened, to host NudgeDoc at a theme park. So we were planning to close the theme park for the day, host NudgeDoc at it in a big venue in the center, and then during the breaks, people could go on the rides. And so that may one day still happen. We're also curious about holding it in a big top. But that's very logistically difficult in the summer, because the British weather is so unpredictable. There's also a chance that we would broadcast kind of live from around the world, which would be amazing, kind of like a Live Aid style, go from all the different regions that we operate in. So there's lots of questions up for debate. So we genuinely are curious about what the Nudgeverse does this year. Whether it becomes a place that people can network, or whether it is a bit of a fad, it's really hard to know. So every year we experiment. I mean, one last year we did the big behavioural science workshop, where we at the start of the day we were briefed live in front of all the people at home, and then the team worked throughout the day to do the work, and then to present the work at the end of the day, which is kind of terrifying and exciting at the same measure. So every year we do something different. So perhaps next year, perhaps it'll be in a theme park, perhaps it'll be on a cruise ship. I mean, who knows? But we're hopefully not going to follow convention, put it that way. It won't be in a convention center, it'll be in a
That sounds
non-convention
amazing.
center.
Yeah. Didn't. I love the idea of doing it at sort of a Legoland or something. It would be brilliant fun. Or Disney. I mean, they must be a client of Ogilvy somewhere in the world. I know we've got some Disney people on 42 courses, so we can make some phone calls after this and make a plan.
Can I just say, I really want to
Maybe
write
we
an
could all go
article
to Disneyland Paris or something.
on, or yeah, I mean, or the Big Daddy Walt Disney World. I
Or,
genuinely think
yeah.
it's not cool to say that. When people say, "What's your favorite brand?" I've really wanted to say this for a while. That people say, "What's your favorite brand?" And, "Oh, it's Nike, or it's Google, and all the great things that they do, or it's Apple." But I genuinely think that Disney is one of the most impressive companies on the planet that has creativity at its heart, and from the very top to the very bottom, and kind of the acquisitions that they make, and the rate of growth that they have, almost it was 100 years on. It's just incredible the way that they're able to charge so much money for Walt Disney World. You can go to the Maldives for cheaper, I think, genuinely, if you get the right hotel.
Yeah.
And yet they don't have a price perception issue. The way that they're able to use creativity to create value is insane. I was watching a video the other day, and you can pay thousands of dollars to go and stay at a Walt Disney World resort, and they can have awful construction on, like awful construction, because they're always making it kind of bigger and better. And the way that they solve that problem isn't through offering massive discounts for the hotel room. It isn't through warning you ahead of time and getting you staying at the hotel and potentially not selling the room. They give you, and we all in kind of pin badges, a big collectible item in the parks. They give you a construction pin badge, a limited edition construction pin badge for staying in the room that has construction in. And they get barely any complaints because people are so happy to get this limited edition pin badge. I stayed at Walt Disney World Resort and it was under construction. And you just think that's an amazing creative, lateral, minimalist, intervention that I don't know, like, many other companies that would get to that. So I think Disney is one of the most impressive organizations. It's just not as cool to say that in the marketing circles, but I think someone needs to say it. I feel like Piers Morgan.
No, I 100% agree with you. I mean, it's a remarkable company, and I think part of the reason in my head would probably be that it's had a very clear and very solid foundation and vision laid out by its founder from the start, and it's still followed. And by companies that do that tend to be quite successful. I think it's no fluke that Ogilvy, out of all of the other massive, ginormous ad agencies, it's one of the few that's still Ogilvy. Like if you think of Y&R or McCann, like a lot of these other sort of massive agency entities have joined other brands or are now brand X and Y joined together. Ogilvy sort of remained, it's just Ogilvy. And I think the part of that is because of David Ogilvy's sort of foundation that it was built on, and the habits that he put on place. If anyone wants to look at that, I think if you Google David Ogilvy habits, you'll find lots of blog articles talking about it. I think I wrote one myself. But yeah, I think when you have that foundation, it just makes things so much easier. Gives people. Without you having to say it out loud all the time, people know what they've got to do, and they know what the company values. And most companies are very bad at doing that.
And it genuinely does also change why the day to day.
People love Tesla partly so much, maybe. Yeah, I agree. Well, look, that was. I think it's a lovely place to land on, a nice place to finish, and a nice point to ponder. But Dan, I adore you, and thank you so much for being you and for taking the time to chat with me, or with us. And I wish you all the very, very best with Nudstock. I'm over the moon, incredibly proud to be a tiny part in helping to sponsor it. And thank you for all you do. And if you want to listen to Dan, then obviously there's a couple of behavioural science courses on 42 courses you can take, and there's a new one coming up very shortly too that will launch at Nudstock this year. So yeah, Dan, thank you so much.
And thank
you're
you,
a legend,
Chris,
and a champion, and I wish you all the best.
And to just say, very grateful that you've made the Nudstock course, because I think it is the Nudstock content over the years is an absolute treasure show. I mean, there's a massive team that put the heart and soul into kind of bringing the very best and the very most, the unique people that we do over for Nudstock. And so to be able to take a course that walks you through the best of that, I think is going to be absolutely all killer, no filler. So thank you for that.
Cheers. I'll chat to you soon. Thank you so much. Bye.
Take care.